We have a good song here to start my message off this morning that the tech folks are going to play for you. So this is pretty good, I think. Thought you were back in VBS, didn't you? How many think that's a new song? How many think it's an old song? Now, you only did that because I'm an old person. Yeah, it is an old song. In fact, I had some old hymn books I looked in and couldn't find it, so I just consulted Mr. Google, and there it is. I thought, hey, that's pretty good. You know, I thought if I found the words, I'd be doing good, but it had kids doing it, so it was even better. So that's our title this morning of what we want to talk about. And most of you know that in the last few weeks when I've preached, I've talked about one of the major prophets in terms of significance, but also size of their books. And so today, it's Daniel. And of course, last time we talked about Ezekiel, and the kind of the big idea there came from the Charles Stanley devotional, where he said that God never intended his children to live a life characterized by defeat. And your thought life, your emotions, your attitudes, and your self-control or your faith. And get this, he said God paid too high a price by sending his son Jesus to die on a cross to have you live a defeated life. And I just really believe that, and that just really excites me. And today, we kind of take it a step further in that we need to be around people, and that's the church, that help us with our journey and that we can influence and that we can gain from. And so that's why I kind of want to go down that road today, because Daniel represents the kind of person that we need to desire to emulate. And so that's kind of where I'm headed today. Got to thinking about people. You know, that's you get more reflective as you age, in case some of you younger people don't understand that. You do. And that's not a bad thing, because somebody said, I think maybe it's Bill Gaither, said you don't want to be looking back, but look in the rearview mirror, I think is the way he puts it. I got to thinking of some people, too many to mention, but a couple came to mind as I prepared this. One is a guy by the name of Armin. Armin died of cancer, probably one of the first persons that I ever knew that died of cancer. But Armin was a farmer, and he was a part of the church my dad ministered to every week up a little bit north of Jefferson, Iowa. Armin was a farmer, and his farm could be in any farm magazine as what a farm really should look like. He always kept the buildings painted. He always had his equipment looking good. and it was just a great place. But Armin was also a great Christian. He taught as the adult Sunday school class in that little church every week without hardly a miss. And was just as a young person, I probably met him when I was about 11 or 12 years old, and had such an admiration just being around him, and even asked him for some advice on some significant issues in my life at that time and later as I got out of high school and that kind of thing. So I know you've probably got people like that too, but Armin was a guy that just really left an imprint on me. Second person is Esty. Some in this room will know who Esty is. Esty was a very spiritual woman who was from this area but had taken up residence at Valley View Village. Probably had one of the first cottages in Valley View Village. But she went to Arizona for the winter, but she came back every year. And I made it a point, and she would be in church, and I would see her, but I made it a point to at least have one visit with Esty every year before she goes back. Went back about Labor Day. And it was a rich experience. A very spiritual woman, read her Bible, read devotional material, had some tough times in life, and had processed all that, and without even trying, just radiated a spirituality that just impacted me. And for those of you who would know a little bit about who William Barclay is, a famous Bible commentator, she took some summer school classes under him, of course, in Glasgow, Scotland, where he lived. So that was always something magnificent. So, you know, we all have had those kinds of people that have helped us in a spiritual way. And I try to write those names down. I try to reminisce a little bit about that. And this morning, I just want to challenge us with the life of Daniel, who lived in a very troubled time, like we do, and he faced significant challenges, and this little song, Dare to be a Daniel. I mean, do you have the courage to try and follow a lifestyle like Daniel? Well, since I took this from two chapters in the Bible, I told Jenna she doesn't have to put that up on the board or on your screen. It'd be kind of long. And so if you have your Bible or your phone or your iPad or your tablet and you would like to get it out, we'll just kind of do it the old-fashioned way today and look at the text and see what we can learn from this story. Now, there's about six major stories in the book, and the first about six chapters contain those, and the last half of it gets into some second coming, Jesus returning type stuff that might be a little difficult, but boy, the front end of it is really rich, and the back is too, but I just want you to know that. You ought to read it. It's not that long a book, but I want us to go to the first chapter and just begin to get acquainted a little bit of what's going on, because this is in the time of the captivity. The Jews, in their unfaithfulness, are taken into captivity, and they end up in Babylon. So, chapter 1, verse 1 says, in the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord delivered Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, along with some of the articles of the temple of God. And these he carried off to the temple of his gods in Babylonia and put them in the treasure house of his God. So stole the stuff out of the temple, took it over to Babylon, and that's the setting that we find ourselves in. But look at the next two or three verses, because this is what we want to focus on. Then the king ordered Ashpenaz, chief of his court officials, to bring in some of the Israelites from the royal family and nobility, young men without any physical defect, handsome, showing aptitude of every kind of learning, well-informed, quick to understand, and qualified to serve in the king's palace. Now, this is the cream of the crop, folks. He was to teach them the language and literature of the Babylonians. The king assigned them a daily amount of food and wine from the king's table, and they were to be trained for 3 years, and after that, they were to enter the king's service. So that's the plan. Basically, we're going to reprogram these guys and use them for our service. And he didn't want just anybody. He wants the best looking, the smartest, and so that's what he went after. Well, verses 6 and 7 said they got renamed, and you know this from at least Bible school stories or Sunday school. Among these, verse 6, some from Judah, Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, the chief official, gave them new names to Daniel, the name Belteshazzar, to Hananiah, Shadrach, to Mishael, Meshach, and to Azariah, Abednego. I don't know whether you ever heard about the little kid that went to Sunday school. When he came home, mom said, "What was the class? What was your class about today?" "Well, we talked about houses." "Houses? In Sunday school?" "Yeah, houses." "What do you mean?" "Well, my shack, your shack, and a bungalow." That's what the lesson was. Kind of corny, but you know. So they were to be reprogrammed. But here's the point. It's verse 8. This is the one, if you want to mark your Bible, this is probably it. But Daniel resolved not to defile himself with the royal food and wine, and he asked the chief official for permission not to defile himself this way. Huh. Get that word there. In fact, in the NIV, the word that is used, he resolved. The New American Standard says he made up his mind, so you can translate it whatever you want to, but Daniel is away from home. I think it's 900 plus miles away from home, and he's about to go into the king's court, and he can do things the king wants him to do, but he resolved to do otherwise. And we could stop right there this morning, folks, and I could just give you a sheet of paper and say, okay, here's your lesson today. Write down all the ways that you can resolve to follow God and not follow the devil and let you go home. But we want to go a little further in that this morning. You see, Daniel is going to cooperate where possible, but he's going to stay firm in his convictions. He set his priorities. And what's the issue here? He's a Jewish boy who was taught to follow at a young age the law of Moses as stated in the first five books of the Old Testament. The Old Testament law. And part of that said, you don't eat meat that's been sacrificed to pagan idols. Well, you might say, what's the big deal? Well, it was a big deal to them. And that was his conviction. And that was the word of God. God had said this. It's in the Old Testament. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. So he's not going to back off of that. And he doesn't. He's not going to do it. So what's Daniel going to do? Well, he's going to make a request. And to the jailer, I guess you'd call him, or whatever this guy was, he said, hey, don't bring us that food that you're supposed to bring us. Just let us eat vegetables and drink water. The Daniel plan. There's a book by that title, isn't there? Yes. So, and that's in verses 9 through 16 is where he says that. So he led out in this man. Well, he's the guard, I guess I've written down here. But again, I'm not going to drink the wine and eat the fatty food. I'm going to drink water and I want vegetables. Well, the guard was a little worked up about that. He said, now wait a minute, you know, I'm responsible for you guys. Now I'm paraphrasing, as you can tell, but I'm responsible for you guys, and I don't know, it could be my head if you guys don't turn out. I said, let's just try it. I think it was for 10 days, isn't it? So that's what happened, and those guys looked fit and great, and the rest of them looked pretty spent, or sometimes people use the word when they're too drunk, wasted. Well, what do we learn from an incident like this? We read this out of the Bible. It's an Old Testament story. It's a significant Old Testament story. So what do we make of this? Well, first of all, Daniel took the lead. And I'd hope every Christian person here would take the lead, be it a youth, a young person, or adults. Step out and be noticed, and don't cave into the pressure. Now, you don't have to strut. You don't have to make a big deal, but stand up for your Christian convictions. If you're a follower of Jesus Christ, you have pledged your life to Him, and part of that means I'm going to learn everything I can about Jesus and God on how to live since I've been placed in this world. I'm going to find out what that means. And for Daniel, the Old Testament law said, don't eat meat sacrificed to pagan idols. Don't do it. So Daniel was willing to maintain his conviction. Don't cave into the pressure. Couple verses for you out of the New Testament. Paul says it as Paul can only say it. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 and 20. This is worth being on the refrigerator door or in your notebook at school. 1 Corinthians 6:19. Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you? Now, there's the verse that tells us we are occupied by the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God. Now get this, you might underline, you are not your own. So all this nonsense that goes on in the culture you and I live in, that it's about me, and I don't have to do that, and all the things that, no, if you're a Christian, you belong to God. You are His possession. And one of the creeds, and creeds aren't inspired, but they say good things. It's not scripture. The chief end of men and women is to bring glory to God. So your purpose here is to try to show off for God. Now, maybe that wasn't a good way to say it, but be an example for God. So, again, you are not your own. And we need to remember that. You were bought with a price. That's what Rick was talking about at communion time. And what Charles Stanley said, God paid a high price for your life and for mine. And we belong to Him. That's a good thing. Now, you might think it's limiting you, but I tell you what, if you remember you belong to God, you're going to stay out of a lot of potholes and stuff in life. You were bought with a price, and He says, therefore, honor God with your body. Now, stop right here and just say a word. All the teaching that you never hear anymore about how you ought to live as a Christian is not to limit your life, but to help you be a vessel that will honor God. That's the why. I think many times we have taught kids and adults things and not said why. The why is you belong to God. Therefore, let's stay out of some stuff that may drag you down the drain to the devil. And you don't want to go there. But we've just about everything most of us has been taught has just been pushed away, and people are just a big mess because they're getting into things that's going to take them down the line. And then 1 Timothy chapter 4, this is for the kids, but it's still for the adults. 1 Timothy 4:12, Paul says to young Timothy, Timothy isn't that young, he's probably 30 plus years old, but here's what he says. Don't let anyone look down on you because you are young. Well, that's true, folks. And we need to encourage our kids and younger people and respect them, but set an example for the believers. Okay, here's the job, kids, adults. We are to set an example for each other. In what areas? He lists them here. Speech. The way you talk is significant. You know why? Because the way you talk only expresses what's in your heart. That's what it's all about. In life, in love, in faith, and in purity. So there's just a couple of verses to kind of hang your hat on for this particular piece right here that we're trying to talk about here this morning. And again, Daniel led out in this manner. And so he just, what he did was he lived out what he believed. I don't know whether you know the name of Jonathan Edwards, but read American history and he's there. Even the revisionist historians cannot escape Jonathan Edwards, a preacher in New England in the 1700s. His famous sermon is Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. Doesn't that sound awful? He read it in a monotone. He wasn't shouting, screaming, jumping on the pulpit, but it was about the wrath of God needs to be taken care of so you don't have to be punished, and God sent his own son Jesus to take that away. So what a blessing. But here's what you don't know about you. You might hear this, but I don't know whether they'll put that in history books or not, but his family, his lineage is known for the number of teachers, lawyers, doctors, and college presidents that came from his family over several generations. One of those that I didn't know was till recently, one of his family was a guy by the name of Timothy Dwight. Now, if you get out of a hymn book, you'll find an old song called I Love Thy Kingdom, Lord. Timothy Dwight was the president of what we know today as Yale University. And guess what? In those days at Yale, they had chapel. What? Chapel at a university? You can't do that. Well, we used to. And he preached evangelistic sermons in the chapel that started a revival. That's back when we had people of conviction. So, again, here's the why, though, of Jonathan Edwards' life. In his 20s, it is said, he wrote down what he believed, and he stuck to it throughout the years. Could we do the same thing? Right, you know, and a lot of times you go to the seminars where they say, write your life statement. Right, you know, and that's good stuff, but let's make a spiritual one. And of course, Daniel took some action. He made a request and he was rewarded for it. A lot of times we don't have the nerve to make a request and ask for something. And you can read in verses 17 through 21 that him and his friends were rewarded. We'll look at verse 20 back there if we get back to Daniel chapter 1. I think it's verse 20. So Daniel and his friends did this, and we've got to do this. In verse 20, 120, Daniel 120. In every matter of wisdom and understanding about which the king questioned them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and enchanters in his whole kingdom. And Daniel remained there until the first year of King Cyrus. Ooh, King Cyrus, you know who he is? He's the guy that let the Jews go back home. And there's a lot of talk about Cyrus today in some other circles, but I won't go into that right now. So, lots of stories in Daniel. I've just taken one of them. But let's ask ourselves the question, what can we learn about Daniel from the rest of his life that will be helpful? Well, number one, and we've got these listed for you on the slides, is that he had self-control. Novel idea, isn't it? Self-control. Verse 8 again, but Daniel resolved not to defile himself with the royal food and wine, and he asked the chief official for permission not to defile himself in that way. See, today, when in Rome, do as the Romans. What happens in Las Vegas stays in Las Vegas. That's what people say all the time. No, if you're a follower of Christ, there's a better way, folks. But everything in our society is excess, eating, drinking, exercising, you name it, push everything to the limits, just do it. Anybody know who Joey Chestnut is? Well, Joey Chestnut won the National Hot Dog Eating Contest again this year. He holds the record. I think the record is 74 hot dogs in 10 minutes. Now, he only achieved 71. That's 70 more than I could eat. 71 hot dogs in 10 minutes. Now, I bet you want to know the next thing I'm going to tell you. How many calories is that? 20,590 calories. I don't know who figured it out, but somebody did. You'd have to figure the bun, the hot dog, the condiments, you know, all the stuff. People do a lot of crazy things, and that's not probably going to cause you to lose your salvation if he happens to be a Christian. I don't know whether it is or not, but I'm just saying that represents the world we live in. Everything's in excess. And Daniel was about self-control. Following Christ is about self-control. Now, we've all got our issues. We've all got things, but we need to think about that. It's a fruit of the Spirit. So we need to think about that. Secondly, courage. Daniel had courage. Look at chapter 5, verse 22. Now, we're skipping around a little bit here, but I think you'll find this interesting. Chapter 5, verse 22. But you, his son, O Belshazzar, have not humbled yourself, though you knew all this. Well, This is the handwriting on the wall story. Isn't it funny? Somebody's going to run into your work and say, well, the handwriting's on the wall. And you ought to say, yeah, you got that right out of the Bible, didn't you? They probably don't know that, but that's where it comes from. Belshazzar's having a wee of a time. He's drinking and eating, and they bring in the goblets from the temple, and he's going to use them. And he does. And after a while, just imagine, over there on that wall, there's a hand. And it writes, and it says he shakes like he has never shook before. And Daniel is called upon again. He interpreted more than one dream. Well, they said, you have been found wanting, and your kingdom is going to fall. You've been weighed into balance, and found wanting. And of course, Daniel was exactly right. But can you imagine now? Daniel's going to tell him, "Hey, you're toast. You're done." That took some courage, I guess. I think. But again, we need to have courage. It amazes me. Over the years, I've watched kids buy the proverbial car. We've turned 16. We're going to get the car, and there's nothing wrong with that. But here's where it goes south. Well, I got a job, and that's not a bad thing. And then you don't see them at youth group or Sunday school or church because of what? They got to work on Sunday. Now, unless you work at Fairway or Chick-fil-A, which I would suggest you maybe start there, you're going to have to work on Sunday. Now, that, again, you're not going to lose your salvation over it, but the devil will use anything he can to weaken us. And I think, hey, I have known a few kids who have said they've gone to their boss, and this is where I'm headed. They've gone to their boss and said, hey, I'm scheduled for Sunday. Could I work another time? Could I work some extra hours or whatever the case may be? Now, not every boss will go along with that, so you're going to have to deal with it. You either stay there or leave. That's your choice. Like I said, maybe you can come up with an alternative plan, but I admire those who have enough in them to say, hey, Is there an alternative here? And then the most important thing is be the best possible employee you can be, because that's the kind of an example a Christian should set. Paul again says, and whatever you do in word or in deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus. If you didn't know it, you're not working for your employer, you're working for God. So keep that in mind. But he had courage. Somebody said, it might have been Hemingway, which I'm reluctant to mention Hemingway from the pulpit, although Hemingway was raised in an evangelical home in Wheaton, Illinois, the center of evangelicalism. And he went south fast. It's a shame. And his life ended a wreck because he committed suicide. But I think it was him who said, courage is grace under pressure. You'd expect something good from him. Well, something like that from him, but that's really pretty good. So, third thing is integrity. Look at chapter 6 and verse 4. And it might not use the word integrity, but here it says, at this, the administrators and the satraps tried to find grounds for charges against Daniel in his conduct of government affairs, but they were unable to do so. They could not find corruption in him because he was trustworthy and neither corrupt nor negligent. Boy, that's a verse to circle in your Bible. I mean, you can't hardly watch the news or open up the paper, but somebody's stealing money from that. One of the most pathetic things I ever heard was a few years ago, somebody stole the money out of the pep band or boosters club. Stole the money out of the boosters club at Lincoln High School. And I thought, how pathetic can you get when they want to have a little money to support the team and somebody can't keep their fingers out of it? That's the world we live in. So we want a desire to be somebody that can be trusted. And I could go on with a whole lot of examples, and I go to seed fast, so I won't. But you know it's there. I mean, come on, folks. Decency says, be honest. Keep your money, hands out of the money. And that kind of thing. Well, Daniel had all kinds of integrity. So we have to ask ourselves the question, will we be honest? Will we do a good job? Will we treat others as Christ wants us to do? I mean, there's all these people that can't treat each other properly. What is the Christian supposed to do? The Christian is called by Jesus to treat others properly. What is it? Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Enough said. And then prayerfulness. Now, chapter 2, verses 17 to 23, Daniel and his friends have a prayer meeting. Now, listen, you're 900 miles away from home. You're a long way out of any family ties. You're in this place, and the king wants you to be used in some way in his service. And what are we going to do? And Daniel said, it's time to pray. In fact, chapter 9 is a great prayer of Daniel's that would be good to use in your devotional time. But you'll find in Daniel's prayer meeting two words, wisdom and power. Well, let's just look at 2:17. We've probably got time to look at this together. Start at 2:17 down through 23. Then Daniel returned to his house and explained the matter to his friends, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. He urged them to plead for mercy from the God of heaven concerning this mystery, so that he and his friends might not be executed with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. And during the night, the mystery was revealed to Daniel in a vision. And then Daniel praised the God of heaven and said, so Daniel's praying. Here's what he said. Praise be to the name of God forever and ever. Wisdom and power are his. Now, those two words we need to remember. God is characterized by wisdom and power. He changes times and seasons. He sets up kings and deposes them. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to the discerning. He reveals deep and hidden things. He knows what lies in darkness, and light dwells in him or with him. I thank and praise you, O God of my fathers. You have given me wisdom and power. You have made known to me what we ask of you and have made known to us the dream of the king. So the life of Daniel is interpreting dreams. It is not bowing down to the king, but honoring God. It is, of course, explaining the handwriting on the wall is in the lion's den, is in the fiery furnace. I mean, it's just great. And those stories have been taught in Sunday school for years. And they're still great, and they're still good for us to look over. Again, God is still, now you think about that. They're captive, and yet he's saying God is still in control. Now, many people say, well, woe is me. I'm 900 miles away from home. I'm a captive. I don't know what I'm going to do. I'm going to wring my hands. No, Daniel says God's still in control. And folks, we're messed up in this country. Like, well, I can only speak about my lifetime. We're pretty messed up, okay? But let's remember, God is still in control. I'm not sure what he's going to do about all this, but I know he's got a plan. He's far smarter than me, and we just need to keep trusting him. We are still his people. We are a remnant. We got a job to do. We need to be a Daniel. We need to be a Daniel to other people. And then, of course, humility. Look at chapter 10. Verses 15 through 17. This is another thing about Daniel. Chapter 10, verse 15. While he was saying this to me, I bowed my face toward the ground and was speechless. And then one who looked like a man touched my lips, and I opened my mouth and began to speak. I said to him, the one standing before me, I am overcome with anguish because of the vision, my Lord, and I am helpless. How can I, your servant, talk with you, my Lord? My strength is gone, and I can hardly breathe. I think of Moses in the cleft of the rock, and God passes over. I can't even imagine, nor like this. Also, there's a whole other avenue we could have gone down here this morning is comparing Joseph of the Old Testament and Daniel. Very parallel situations. Again, called upon to be faithful to God when you've been done wrong and when you're far away from home. And one last one here is spiritual vision in chapter 7. Chapter 7, verse 11. Just one last thing here to consider this morning. And again, I'm just cruising through the book. It's rich. And then I continued to watch. This is 7:11. Because of the boastful words the horn was speaking, I kept looking until the beast was slain and his body destroyed and thrown into the blazing fire. Excuse me. And then he continues, the other beasts had been stripped of their authority, but were allowed to live for a period of time. In my vision, at night I looked, and there before me was one like the Son of Man, coming with the clouds of heaven. He approached the Ancient of Days, and he was led into the presence, and he was given authority, glory, and sovereign power. All peoples, nations, men of every language worshipped him. His dominion is in the everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that will never be destroyed. I'm talking about spiritual vision. He had spiritual vision. Right here he had a vision, and you and I might not have a vision, but I think you can have spiritual vision. That's if you're communing with God on some kind of a regular basis. God will give you that kind of vision. So this morning I'm just asking that we might realize that the local church, the body of Christ, the ecclesia, the called out brethren, that's you and me, we're together here in this part of the country, and we have lives to live in different places. Now you just sit down sometime with a sheet of paper and a pencil and start writing down, if you know people well enough, where they work or where they live, and get a clue or an idea about the influence that we can have as Christian people, because even though we're a group here this morning, we're going to spread out and be in several other places, and that we might live for Christ, that we might have these qualities that Daniel had, that we might make a difference in this world because we live a little bit differently. And the reason we do is because we're following Jesus of Nazareth, who has saved us from our sins. The least we can do, the least we can do is to live a spiritual, Christian, visionary life, so people might notice and they might ask you why, and you get a chance to tell them. Let me close with this morning. How many of this is an old movie, but it's a good one. Chariots of Fire. Oh, this is a new crowd, huh? Makes it better, the illustration better yet. It's worth getting. I'm sure it's available on Netflix and everybody else. Chariots of Fire is a movie about a guy by the name of Eric Liddell. He was called the Flying Scotsman. He was a runner. He won everything. He was a Christian. And he went to the 1924 Olympics in Paris, France. And when he looked at the chart, it said, he was the son of missionary parents. China is where they were missionaries, which is a whole other story to talk about. He's a 100 meters guy. His race was going to be Sunday. Eric Liddell said, I can't run on Sunday. It's the Lord's day. Wow. And they said, what do you mean? And this is just once in a lifetime. It's the Lord's day. In fact, I'm going to address some college-age teenagers on what it means to follow Christ. Well, they agonized and agonized and agonized, and he said, well, there's 400 meters. Now, you think about that, 100 meters to 400 meters. I'll run that. That wasn't his race. 100 meters was his race. He won it. He set a record. He told his sister, Jenny, God has made me fast for a purpose, and I need to use that purpose for his glory. And again, he believed that he could not serve God and run on Sunday. Now, that may not be an issue with you, but according to what he believed in his system of spirituality, he wanted to honor the Lord's day. And he was a legend. He, after getting out of college, he went back to China. He died in China in a Japanese internment camp serving the Lord. He did marry, and I think they had one or two children. She finally left. He had her leave and go back to Canada, so she must have been Canadian or British, just for safety's sake. This was in and around World War II, and you got to flip. You got to get yourself all reprogrammed, because in those days, Japan was the enemy and not our friend like they are now, and China was our friend, and they're not exactly maybe an enemy, but they're not our best people. So you got to reprogram yourself. But he was taking the gospel, teaching people. And again, they said, one guy said he was the most humble guy he'd ever met. Now, folks, we may not to be an Eric Liddell, but I think we can be inspired by the stories of Eric Liddell, Jonathan Edwards. The list goes on and on. We can also be inspired by the Armin Millers, the S.D. Brants that I told you about, and you got a list of people too. And then we can aspire to be them. That's what I would want to leave you this morning, is I challenge you to be a Daniel so you might influence other people for Christ.